We'll now begin with the talk series. For the first talk, we are very fortunate to have Professor G. Ambika, who is a very accomplished scientist, with us today. Professor Ambika has been serving as the chair of physics department since 2018 and also as a coordinator of the academic program since 2019 at the Indian Institute of Science Education and Research, ISET Tirupati. She has also been a member of the board of editors in the European Physical Journal Special Topics, EBJST, since October 2019. Coming to her research interests, her work mainly focuses on the study of emergent states in the complex system and their complexity measures from observational data. She has several publications in distinguished journals. Her research work has also been featured in news a number of times for the new developments brought into the diagnostic world. Apart from being a great researcher, Professor Ambika is also a great teacher who has been guiding several undergraduate and graduate students. And today, she will be sharing with us her knowledge on the topic in host dynamics in disease model. This year, with most of the teams losing wet lab work and focus being shifted to modeling, her topic will surely help all the participating teams. Before we go ahead with the talk, I request all the participants to mute themselves. And in case if any of you have questions, we request you to post them in the chat box or wait till the end and ask during the discussion session right after the talk. Now, without any further delay, over to you, ma'am.
Hello, good morning. Can you hear me?
Yes.
Yeah. So let me start. I cannot start my video, but that's okay. So good morning to all of you. I'm very excited to meet all of you, to talk to all of you and interact with all of you. This is a very good, IGEM is a very good procedure that is being done at the undergraduate level for research. So maybe I can start sharing my screen and then we'll start the talk. Okay. So as was mentioned by Purva, I'm going to talk to you a few things about in-host dynamics in disease modeling. So disease modeling is a very interesting aspect of modeling in biological systems where a lot of physics related issues will come, and physics as well as mathematics will come. And we will see, I'll start with a very basic model and we will tell you how to go ahead doing a modeling. So this is basically confined to disease modeling, and that too confined to in-host modeling of disease. So when we generally talk about modeling disease dynamics, we talk about epidemics modeling, endemics modeling, and recently we are hearing every day about pandemics modeling in the context of coronavirus and COVID-19. But my talk is restricted to in-host dynamics. That means what is the type of dynamics that happens inside the host. So this is not about community spreading or how it spreads from one person to another person, but only within that host. That's the only thing that I am talking about. So there itself, when you talk about in-host dynamics, there are one or two different aspects that you have to consider. One is chronic infections, like with pathogens such as that happens in HIV, hepatitis B, hepatitis C, tuberculosis, etc. I will take specific cases of all these and explain to you how to go from one type to the other. And there are acute infections which are not over long time, which are called influenza, or some of them are influenza, dengue virus, malaria, etc. Now, how do we start modeling a system, in-host dynamics of a system? Basically, we want to know the mechanisms governing the host pathogen kinetics. That's the main thing. And then, of course, there should be biological data available so that we can understand about the processes that underlie the host pathogen kinetics. And so by doing all these things, we will be able to guide human interventions for stopping of the disease or controlling of the disease. So basically, because these are complicated systems, complex dynamics with the nonlinearity coming in at every step, mostly we have to rely on numerical investigations and data fitting. But I will also explain a few analytical things that one can do from a point of view of dynamical systems theory. So these numerical investigations and the data fitting of in-host models, they will also help to estimate the biological parameters. Because when you talk about fitting them, I mean, when you talk about developing a model, it involves a large number of variables as well as a large number of parameters. So we should have some estimate about the magnitude or at least the range of values for these parameters. For this, we rely upon data that is available and try to fit them so that we can estimate these parameters. And then these models can also be used to estimate the efficiency or efficacy of different drug therapies and the strength of the immune responses. And ultimately, our aim will be to predict the outcome of the disease. So basically, when we try to do all these things, when you try to introduce more and more flavors into it and more processes into it, it becomes really complex. And one has to worry about a trade-off between the complexity of the model and their predictive power. I will take you through these steps one by one. So we will start with a very basic model, which can be used for acute and chronic pathogenic infections. And then I will try to introduce immune responses into that basic model. And a few things like role of drug therapy, I will take with specific examples like HIV. Then how time delay in immune response is important, that I will consider by taking the example of dengue. And data fitting, I will consider one specific case of COVID-19. And in the end, I will also talk about what are the limitations of these basic models and how to make improvisations on them and go ahead with adding more and more processes into that. Now, when you talk about modeling the in-host dynamics, as I said, we should have some awareness about the cells that the pathogen is infecting and the time scale of the infection of the host. That means they can be long-lived and persistent, which I called earlier as chronic, or they can be short-lived, which I called as acute infections. We should also have some idea about the life cycle of the pathogen, which includes all of the different methods by which the pathogen can produce a progeny. So details of the basic model will depend upon all these various factors and may vary from pathogen to pathogen type. For example, whether it is a virus, a bacteria, parasite, etc. However, the format of the basic model for each type is very similar. So I will be talking mostly about virus, but I will also tell you how to make some changes when you have a bacteria in consideration. Now, this whole branch of science dealing with this is called the microepidemiology. Epidemiology normally deals with the spread of diseases, spread of infections, etc. But when we talk about in-host dynamics, we call it microepidemiology. That means the spread of infectious agents within individuals. And also, this includes interaction with the immune system and response to treatments of drugs. So, when we talk about a very basic model, we will worry only about three variables. One is the target cell or host cells. This model is something like a population dynamics model with which most of you must be familiar. So our variables are actually counts, numbers. So X stands for the number of uninfected cells or target cells or host cells. And Y stands for the number of infected cells. And V stands for the active virus. So we will start with these three variables and we will see how to develop a basic model and then we will go on extending it. So this is biologically, normally this whole process is shown like a schematics like this. This is taken from the book of Novak and May called the Virus Dynamics. So what is it that is promoting the growth and what is it that is introducing the death of the cell? That is what is shown here as the parameters. So the variable X, how does it vary with time? How does the number of uninfected cells vary with time? One is its growth. So for a simple model like this, I am considering a constant rate of growth or rate of production of the variable X, which is the uninfected cell. So it is added as a parameter lambda. And then average lifetime is 1 by D, which means D is its death rate. So D into X represents the number of cells that are lost by death. And then we are talking about an infectious model. So because of that, the virus will infect the cell and therefore the number of healthy cells or uninfected cells will go down. So there is a minus sign with a parameter beta which takes care of the extent to which this is successful. And in the interaction, it is the interaction between the uninfected cells and the virus. So the product X into V here. So this explains how the number of uninfected cells X can vary in time. Now, Y represents the infected cells. So it is increasing or it is being produced because of the interaction between the uninfected cell and the virus. So beta into XV comes here with a positive sign, but it also has a death rate or the rate at which it is being removed from the system. Therefore, it is minus A into Y. Now, the virus has a replication rate, which is K. This is the way how the rate at which it is produced from the variable Y. So it is K into Y and U here is a parameter which takes care of its own death rate. So 1 by u will be the average lifetime of the virus. So therefore, this explains a very simple model. As you can see, only there are two terms which are non-linear, but otherwise it is sort of a linear model, the simplest possible one. And this is what is schematically shown on this side also, how the virus affects the uninfected cell, infects it, and how that uninfected cell is producing the virus. And these arrows indicate how they are getting removed from the body. Now, in the absence of infection, you can see that in the absence of infection means the virus count is zero initially. Then very soon, X will saturate to a value of lambda by D. That you can see, because it's a very simple differential equation. So basically, it's a three-dimensional model for three variables, X, Y, and V. And these are represented by ordinary differential equations, which we can solve. To some extent, it is easy to solve it. We will see how to do it.
Now, excuse me, ma'am.
Yes.
Sorry to interrupt, but could you please switch on your video? Like, we have changed a few settings and I think it would be possible now.
Let me see. I tried start the video. It says you cannot start the video because the host has stopped it. You have to do something from your side, I think.
Please continue with your presentation, ma'am. We'll look into it.
Okay. Are you still seeing my screen? Yes,
ma'am. We can see your screen.
Okay. Let me go to this model. Okay. Okay. So coming to method of analysis for this simple three-dimensional model of host virus dynamics. One thing that we can do is, most often we are interested in the asymptotic state of the system, which we call as the equilibrium state. That means as time t tending to infinity, even though we say t tending to infinity, for you biologists it's a long time, that's all. So within that long time, what happens? Will this system settle to some values? If they settle to some values, that means we call that state as x star, y star, v star, which are the equilibrium values of these variables. And then it means that after that, there is no dynamics for them, which means you put the right hand side of these equations to zero. There is no dx by dt or x naught, it is zero. Similarly, no dy by dt, no dv by dt. So they are all zero. And then by putting it like that, these equations, if you solve, it will give you the values of this. Now, the important thing is, now you are getting these values x star, y star and v star as a function of the parameters of the problem, lambda, d, beta, A, K, U. So all these parameters will be involved. Now, once you get a solution for this, because this is only three-dimensional, you can actually do it manually. But if you have more dimensions, you can always use some software like Mathematica and solve it. And once you get the solutions, first thing is to check for their existence. Existence actually in this context is very simple because these are counts or numbers. So we want all of them to be positive. They cannot be negative, that's all. But what decides that is the value of the parameters. So we will check the values of the range of the values of the parameters where they can be positive. Now, it is not enough if we get that. We have to check the stability of this equilibrium state, because mathematically we found a solution for the equilibrium state, but we are not very sure whether this is going to get you into a stable situation. So that means whether it will remain there as time goes off, or a very small change will cause it to go away from that equilibrium. So we are trying to check that also. So how do we check that? Suppose the system has reached a state where it is in equilibrium, or in the values of the parameters that we have shown there. A very small perturbation or change from that can take it away from that, then it is unstable. If it is going back to that state, even after a very small change or perturbations, then that means it is a stable system. So how do we check that? For that, we have to go to the Jacobian of the equations. So suppose we take x naught, this f represents whatever function we had here, like that lambda, dx, etc. G represents the function on the right-hand side of the y equation. H represents that on the right-hand side of the v equation. Then we can write the Jacobian as this df by dx, df by dy, df by dv, like that. And then you evaluate this Jacobian at the value of the equilibrium points. That means at x star, y star, v star. Which means now the Jacobian also will finally have only elements which are depending on the parameters. And we evaluate the eigenvalues of this Jacobian. For a 3x3 matrix like this, it's very easy to evaluate the eigenvalues. And the condition for stability is that the eigenvalue should have negative real parts. So that means any perturbation that happens to the system from the equilibrium will damp in course of time and it will go to zero. So the perturbation will go to zero. That means the system will remain in that state of equilibrium. That means the equilibrium is stable. Now, if you have higher dimensions, it is not that easy to analytically get the expressions for the eigenvalues. But there are some conditions like Ruth for this condition, which I can give you some references. This will tell you whether the eigenvalues have negative real parts. And in some cases, we construct a function called a Lyapunov function from the differential equations. And then we identify whether the Lyapunov function is stable or not as time goes. That also will tell you about the stability. So all these things are the methods of analysis that you can do. So once you have got the equilibrium state like this, this is what I am now calculating the equilibrium state for the particular basic model that I have shown. It is simple to calculate and you will find that it has two equilibrium state. One is called a disease-free equilibrium state and the other is an infected equilibrium state. So this is not infected, this is infected. So this disease-free equilibrium is disease-free because it has only lambda by T for X star, Y star and V star are zeros, which means the virus count asymptotically goes to zero. The infected cells also go to zero. So system is free of the disease. On the other hand, here we have values for X star, Y star, V star, which again depends on the parameters. Here I introduce a very important parameter called R0, which is called the reproduction ratio, which in for this particular case, it comes as beta lambda k divided by ADU. So in terms of that, you can again write this infected in equilibrium state. You find that this is R0 minus 1 here. This is also R0 minus 1, which means if R0 is greater than 1 only, this will be positive. Similarly, the virus count will also be positive when it is greater than 1 only. So the existence of the infected equilibrium demands that R0 should be greater than 1. So this R0 is an important parameter in disease dynamics. It's defined as the expected number of secondary infections produced by an infected cell. If it is less than 1, we say it is subcritical and the infection will be eventually cleared from the system. If it is greater than 1, we call it explosive multiplication, which is only limited by the availability of X. So this particular model is called a target cell limited model because when the infection can stop, even from all the uninfected cells are converted into infected cells, then also there is nothing to infect and therefore the disease may stop. So damped oscillations to equilibrium abundances are possible. And if you check the stability also, we will find that E0 is stable when R0 is less than or equal to 1, while E1 is stable for R0 greater than 1. So this also you can check. Now, so because this is a nonlinear system having coupled equations means in the X equation, the variable V is coming. In the Y equation, again, the variable X is coming. So it is the equations are all coupled. So because of that nature of its coupling as well as the nonlinearity in the problem, it's not that easy to solve it numerically, to solve the differential equations numerically. The maximum we can do is we can check for the asymptotic state and its stability. However, we can solve the equations choosing some initial conditions and parameter values by numerically. That is very simple. One simple method one always uses is Ohm-Ekuta method. It's an algorithm for solving ordinary differential equations. It is important to do fourth order Ohm-Ekuta because this will reduce the numerical error in this thing. And you can use this to find the short-term dynamics and long-term dynamics. And there is another modified method which is called Adams-Bashford method, which is very important in cases where you have the parameter values having very different ranges of values. Because if you look at this equation once again, you find that lambda, d, beta, they are all parameters. So depending on the context, suppose the order of magnitude of d is very different from the order of magnitude of this beta. So then that means the orders of the magnitudes of the terms on the right hand side of the equation may differ very much. Then the Ohm-Ekuta algorithm will not give you very good results. You go to this Adams-Bashford method, which will give you a very good result. So this is just to indicate how we finally numerically do it and plot it. This is the X value and the Y value, and this is the virus count. Now, we take the specific case of chronic infections, which is HIV pathogenesis. Here, the variable X and Y represent the uninfected and the infected CD4 T cells. This is the immune cells of the body. As you know, HIV is actually affecting the immune cells. So here, the X variable itself is the immune cells. And by fitting the value of V that we get the model to longitudinal HIV patient data, that means the patient data taken in a sequence, we can identify the parameters and calculate the reproduction ratio, and it's not in, for a normal set of values, you find R0 works out to be 8. Now coming to hepatitis B and hepatitis C, here the X and Y uninfected and infected cells are the liver cells of the hepatocytes. In this particular case, we say do some modification to make it better to explain this hepatitis B and hepatitis C. The liver has ability to regenerate, and we therefore include two logistic growth terms instead of this steady or the constant rate of growth. And also, we have to add some terms for the proliferation of uninfected and infected hepatocytes. Also, there is a possibility that the infected hepatocytes can be cured. So therefore, a fraction of the infected cells will add to the uninfected cells in course of time. So therefore, as you can see, here I have added a logistic growth term in addition to this lambda minus dx and this term. And also, a fraction of the infected cells is getting cured and added to the x variable. Now, in the y variable also, we have a logistic term. And then this minus rho I, which is getting cured and goes back to here. So it is subtracted from the y equation. So this is how we modify that basic model to take care of this hepatitis case. And the current estimates gives you R05 for hepatitis B and 7.2 for hepatitis C. Now, if you come to acute virus infections, because the hepatitis as well as the HIV are chronic infections, that means infection stays in the system for a long time. On the other hand, there are infections like influenza, dengue, and Zika viruses, where the virus dynamics is very fast. That means recovery and clearance is gained over a short period of time. So in that case, the target cell production and death rate can be ignored, because during that time, we can assume that the production and the decrease in the rate can be ignored. And therefore, in the X dot equation, you keep only this term. So we are simplifying the basic model to take care of the case where you have an acute virus infection which stands for a short time. So everything else remains the same, and then the equation becomes simplified and you can solve it. Now, in such cases, especially in the case of influenza, we always consider an additional latent phase, or they call it eclipse phase. I don't know why it is called eclipse, but latent, I feel, is a better word. It shows that the infected cells may initially remain for some time in a latent phase. Then only they actually start becoming infectious or active infectious cells to produce the virus. So we add another variable E in between X and Y to take care of this latent phase or eclipse phase. So actually this is what is produced from the interaction of the X and V variables. And then it has a death rate, and also the fraction of this will be converted to Y, which is the active infectious state, infected cells. So there's minus PE here, plus PE here, and the remaining things are the same. So this slight modification will help you to add that. So this is for the chronic case, and this is for the acute infection case. You can add this another extra variable E. For this also, one can work out the asymptotic state. The disease-free state is the same, but the infected equilibrium also is almost the same with the redefinition of your R0. Now, R0 will depend upon these additional parameters also. So the R0 value is different, and this is the E star value. Everything else remains the same, but you have added this extra variable. So with that, you can actually do a numerical analysis and see how these variables are changing with respect to time. Now, when we talk about, so far I was talking mainly about virus. Now, when we talk about pathogens which are bacteria, there is an additional thing you have to worry. As a specific case, I am considering this Mycobacterium tuberculosis, which is called MTB. This is the pathogen that causes tuberculosis. Now, this bacteria has an additional thing that it can replicate through division and proliferation on its own, and also through the target cell. Because as you must be knowing that the virus cannot replicate on its own unless it gets help from a target cell. But bacteria is not like that. It can replicate on its own also. So how do we modify it? So it has infection of target cells which produce this bacteria, which is released into the body, and it can divide on its own also. So I'm keeping the same variable V same symbol for the variable, but this in this case is bacteria, not virus. So here the additional thing that you have to add is you have to add a function here, function of V, which is the replication function for the pathogen. A simple case to consider will be a logistic growth model as RV into 1 minus V by K. This K here, as you know, is the carrying capacity. So we have added that, and then we can do this model to solve for a situation like this tuberculosis infection. Now, so far we consider a very basic model. We have only uninfected cells, infected cells and virus. But how does control of disease happens? It can happen in many different ways. One is our own innate immune system countering the disease. So we have to actually add in the dynamics of the immune system. So it comes in two ways. Either it is through T cells, which are CD8 cells and CD4 cells, which can destroy the infected cells. And it can come as B cells, which produce antibodies that bind to the virus and destroy it. So immune system can have two processes, T cells and B cells. And also we can think about vaccines. When the immune system fails to control, we can have human interventions which will give the required immune capacity. Or we can think of drugs which can be given to control this. So we will now think about how to improvise your model to include all these things. First thing is to introduce the immune system response. The system becomes now a four-dimensional model. So we are including the immune system as a count of these cytotoxic T lymphocytes or CTL cells. So the CD4 helper cells help to produce from CD8 cells to produce these CT4 CTL killer cells, which can interact with the infected cell and kill it. So I am adding it here through another variable Z, and this variable Z will interact with the infected cells and reduce their number. So we are adding a term minus P into YZ here to take care of that. And this the CTL cells will increase based on that C YZ, because it is in response to the infected cells that it is being produced, and then it is getting destroyed based on this number. So the cytotoxic T lymphocytes or CTL, which is actually activated CD8 T cell, they will contribute to the immune response and kill the infected target cells. So one can work out the dynamics here, and you find that here we have a reproduction ratio R1, which is given like this. So it takes care of the parameters C, P and B, which we now introduced as new. And then we can discuss the dynamics. Here we find that there is an infection-free equilibrium, just like the three-dimensional model, which is stable only for one condition, that C Y star should be less than B. So C, you can see, is the parameter that comes here. Y star is the equilibrium value of this, and B is the death rate of the CTL cells. And E1, which is the infected state, is stable if this C Y star is greater than B. So we call this as the activation threshold. These are the expressions that you get for all these stable equilibrium states. So C greater than 0 will certainly reduce the virus load. For small C, Z is low and V is high. We call it, there is a negative correlation between Z and V. For large C, V and Z are low and positive correlation. Now, as we said, the immune response can be through CTL or it can be through the antibody responses which are produced by the B cells. So if you include that antibody response also, then you have a five-dimensional dynamics, including CTL and antibody response. So here, this first equation is the same. The second equation is also the same because it is the CTL which is interacting with the infected cell. But the antibody response W here is interacting with the virus. So we have a minus QVW term added here. And this is the multiplication of the or production of the antibody. And this again is the same which produces that. So now it becomes a five-dimensional model. So there are some diseases where both responses are equally relevant or important. In such cases, we should have the immune response added using CTL as well as antibody. Now, talking about the effect of drug therapy. So suppose we want to introduce some drug. How will you introduce it into our model? Where will it affect the system? So this is basically, I mean, thinking in terms of the HIV situation. So the drug can be introduced into the system by two means. There are drugs which are RTI or reverse transcriptase inhibitors. This will prevent free virus from infecting the cells. And there are also drugs given which are called the protease inhibitor. That means it prevents infected cells from producing infections. So depending upon the nature of the drug that you are administering, you can modify the corresponding. So we will say, we dynamical systems people will say that the introduction of the drug is like a parametric perturbation to the dynamics. So parametric perturbation means some parameters are affected because of that. So as you can see, in the first case where it is getting affected, you can say this beta parameter is now changed as beta into 1 minus another factor eta. So this beta into 1 minus eta will take care of this one type of drug that is being infected. So it will prevent prevents infected cells from producing infectious virus. So therefore it comes in the beta factor, beta parameter. So here again beta becomes beta into 1 minus eta. Everything else is the same. Now if you have the other drug which is actually preventing free virus from infecting the cells, then it should go into this parameter K, where you introduce it as K into 1 minus epsilon. So this epsilon and beta, generally we say, are the efficacies, drug efficacies. They have values lying between 0 and 1. They are normalized values that we are introducing. And then with that we can see how this is affecting. And here now I have added another variable V1, which is actually the non-infectious virus. Because when the drug is actually converting this infectious virus into non-infectious type, so that count also can be there, which is taken care of by adding another variable V1, which varies like this. So with all these things, this is one way of introducing the drug therapy into your in-host dynamics. Now there is a problem. When you introduce this effect of drug, it is not exactly correct to add it as a constant parameter, because you know that drugs are always administered in repeated dosages, because of which the drug function, the effect of the drug also has to be a periodic function or at least time dependent function. So this we introduce as a parametric perturbation. So beta, instead of being 1 minus epsilon, it should be 1 minus epsilon, which is a function of t. So to introduce the periodicity into the drug function, one simple way is to, I'll show you better ways later. One simple way is to put it as some epsilon 0, which is the constant or the dormant concentration of the drug in the blood, plus some factor which changes with time. So there is a time scale involved here, which is very important, because how the concentration of the drug in the body first increases, then decreases, then another dose comes, again it increases, decreases. So in general, we can say that it is going like a sine squared, like this. Now I will take some modifications to the basic model, taking specific cases. As I said, I will deal with three cases: HIV, dengue, and COVID. Now, in the case of HIV, we can improvise the model by considering the possibility that the infected cells can, in general, be of three types. They are short-lived virus-producing ones, long-lived chronic producers, and defectively infected. And the virus can also be of two types. One is active virus and the other is the drug-resistant or the mutant virus. So if you introduce all that, the model that we have seen earlier now will become a 10-dimensional model. So as you can see, what is being produced, each parameter numbers also goes on increasing. So there is a mutant virus as well as a drug-resistant virus as well as active virus. And we have the infected cells of three types, I equal to 1, 2, 3. The three types is short-lived, long-lived, and defectively infected. And the defectively infected ones are not going to produce the virus. So the virus is produced only by Y1 and Y2, not by Y3. Similarly, this is the mutant virus, which is produced only by this other one, which is the YM1, YM2, which we have introduced as the corresponding mutant variety. So this is actually the infected cells produced by the mutant virus. And we have this immune response added in the last one. So introducing this is a very high dimensional model, 10 dimensional model, which incorporates all these things. As I said, depending upon your requirement, you can go on adding more and more processes and possibilities and make your model, expand your model. So this is schematically how you show this 10-dimensional model works. And as you know, the number of parameters are increasing. I'm just showing you one sample set of values that I have chosen. And here we find that the asymptotic state is a state of infective equilibrium, because the active virus or the wild virus is still there. It is not zero. So this is stable because we find the eigenvalues of the Jacobian has negative real parts. So being in a 10-dimensional model, I solved it for these equilibrium states using Mathematica, then evaluated the eigenvalues of the Jacobian. So this is actually the CTL count versus viral. So when you have a 10-dimensional model, the phase space also is 10-dimensional, but I am considering them as two some planes, like one is CTL count here and viral dot here is a 2-dimensional plane of the 10-dimensional model. This is again CTL count and the number of uninfected cells. So this is the infective equilibrium case. This dot shows mutant one, the line shows the wild one. And now into this, so we found that there is an infective equilibrium which is stable in that model. So one way to reduce, make it non-infective is to add the drug therapy. So I am introducing this epsilon t as a periodic function like this. And then we find that for large dosages, we can go to a non-infective equilibrium, which is shown here. The active wild virus goes to zero. Here they settle to a value like this. So now these are, so we find that when this happens, actually the system is going from an equilibrium state. When the drug is not having enough concentration or enough dosage, they are not going to that state. Then it is going through a state of limit cycles or periodic oscillations like this. Here I am showing it in a 3-dimensional space of CTL count here, host cells here, and viral load here. This is just to visualize how the dynamics actually happens. And with increasing drug dose, we find that it goes through a transition like this, and finally it becomes very small in amplitude like this. So the short-term dynamics, as you can see, goes like this. This full line is for the wild type, the other is for the mutant type. And this is the short-term dynamics for the cell counts, CTL count and the uninfected cell count. Now, because we have a 10-dimensional model, I have introduced another way of dealing with the problem. This is called the principal component analysis, which is most often used in data analysis. So here I am using it to find out which are the very effective directions in which the dynamics is proceeding. So what we do is we find out the prominent eigenvalues of you by doing the principal component analysis, two eigenvalues, the most prominent, which are F1 and F2. And what are the components or the variables that go into the corresponding eigenvectors? So when you do a PC analysis, you will get the weightage of each variable in the corresponding eigenvector. So that weightage is what is plotted here. One good thing here is that we can actually see when a transition happens. So when the underlying dynamics of the system undergoes a transition, the weightages are shifting. So there are two values where you can see there's a sudden change. So the variable in the x direction is the epsilon, which is the dose, the strength of the drug that is administered. So as it reaches one particular value around 3.5, there is a transition you can see because the weightages change. Similarly, for the second eigenvalue also we can say there is a weightage that is changing. So that means if the active virus is actually reducing, its weightage in that particular component of the eigenvector will also reduce. So this is just one to illustrate how one can deal with a higher dimensional model. Now, we introduce a very simplified expression for the periodic drug function as a sine square term, t by tau. But in general, it need not be, if you actually look at the pharmacokinetics of any drug, that means how the concentration of the drug in the body varies, then you will see that it can vary in different ways. So for example, it actually varies in a pattern. It increases initially fast and then it goes down very slow like this. Then again, the second dose comes, goes up, comes down, goes up, comes down like that. So I have introduced, in fact, I have coined an expression for this epsilon t, which gives you the efficacy of the drug as a function of all these things. So when you put in all these functions, you see it exactly matches with the experimentally observed pharmacokinetics of the drug. So one can use this function in the place of that and then calculate that. So here I am calculating the virus load with and without the drug. This red one is without the drug and the green one is with the drug. So one can do the calculations based on that also. So that was for HIV. What I have shown is how to develop it into a higher dimensional model. And when you have a higher dimension, how do you do an analysis? And also most important, when you introduce the drug, how do you monitor the pharmacokinetics of the drug and the periodic function or the periodic variations in the drug concentration and how will it affect? So I have shown a very simplified case, but one has to be careful because the time scale of the drug and the time scale of the system dynamics need not be the same. So in a way, you can decide that by the periodicity with which the drug is to be administered can be adjusted based on that. So that is a very important factor that you have to keep in mind. Now I come to the case of a dengue infection. So this is also an infection which all of you have heard about. But what I would concentrate is, what is this dengue fever caused by and how do we take care of secondary infection? So primary infection is the first one that you get. And in course of time, you may develop high fever, but in course of time, 7 to 14 days, you will be cured of the primary infection. But if you happen to get another infection within a very short time, short time means the antibodies produced from the primary infection are still in your body, and then you get a secondary infection, then it is a very, very dangerous situation. It can even become fatal. So my aim is to find out why the secondary infection is more serious, because it can develop DHF, which is called the dengue hemorrhagic fever, or dengue shock syndrome, DSS, which is actually due to the enhanced antibody which is present in the body. So how do you take care of this and give a reasonable dynamical model for this? As you know, the dengue virus comes in four different types, which we call as DenB 1, 2, 3, 4. And the immune response in this case is mostly antibody response. But this antibody response incorporates some intercellular time delays, because this is a situation where we have to introduce a delay in the differential equations, because the response of the antibody or the production of the antibody comes through a process, a few biological processes. First, it will produce these B cells, and then B cells will produce some plasma cells which gets converted to antibody. So this involves a delay. So this delay has to be incorporated into the dynamics of the system. And once you introduce a delay, the dynamics of the system becomes infinite dimensional, strictly speaking. So I will explain how do we do that. And also here, between the primary and the secondary dengue infections, there is a correlation factor that I am introducing, because it gives a measure of the similarity between the different serotypes. And the higher the similarity, the greater is the danger of the secondary infection. And the content of the antibody from the primary infection is what decides the severity of the secondary. For this, I am introducing a dynamical switch into the problem. This will also help you to understand how that control can happen. So this is how biology students will model the processes of dengue infection. I would prefer to look at this diagram on the right hand side, which simply says, here I have, this is susceptible cells, infected cells, this is virus. And then the presence of the virus produces the beta cells and the B cells, and the B cells produce the antibody. Here there is a delay. So there is a delay here, which is the production of the antibody from the B cells. And there is an overall delay before this antibody will start acting on the virus. So to take care of all these things, I am introducing two delays, tau 1 and tau 2. So this is the infected, uninfected cell or susceptible cell. This is almost the same as what we have done earlier. This is infected cell, that's also the same. Here, this is the virus, and the virus is compacted by the antibody. So the term here is antibody into virus. This is the B cell count, which also you have to take care. So this is the B cell count, which is actually because of the interaction of the B cell with the virus. And the antibody is produced from the B cells like this. Here B cell, and then it has its, it is being, antibody interacts with the virus, and then it also gets killed because of that interaction, and then it has its own normal death rate. So here is where I'm introducing two delays, tau 1 and tau 2. So as I said, when you have delays in the system, the equations are no longer simple ordinary differential equations. We call them delay differential equations, and these delay differential equations are generally very complicated because they are infinite dimensional, because the delay is a continuous delay. So in general, to understand how it becomes a higher dimensional system because of the delay is to look at the number of initial values that you have to put in to solve the numerical equations numerically. Suppose the delay is not there. To solve this system, which is 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 dimensional system, you have to put in the numerical analysis the initial values of all these systems. You will put some 10 raised to 4 for this. This will be 0 initially. This can also be 0. This is some value you can put. Here also some value. So only 5 values you are putting in as initial conditions. So in a way, we can say that is the 5-dimensional system. Now, the moment there is a delay here, When you put in the value at time t equal to 0 for b, that is not enough. This equation requires the value of b at time t equal to t minus tau 2. So this makes it, that means the system needs values of b, many more values at different timings. So what we do is, in terms of the time step of integration, suppose your tau 2 is 10 time steps. We have to add 10 values starting from t minus 10 to t minus 9, t minus 8, t minus 7, like that till t. So these many initial values are required. So which means the system has now become much, much higher dimensional. But we cannot help it, because in biological systems, biological processes sometimes take a lot of time. It has a complicated pathway and it needs time to produce antibody from the B cell once the virus is infected. So this is required. So when you want to add that, you add it, and then when you know numerically solve it, you take care of that. So this, I'll skip this slide, because this is only explaining all the parameters which we have earlier seen. And now I will explain why these two delays and what are they. So we have a total time delay tau 1, which is introduced through the Heaviside step function. So Heaviside step function, for those of you who are not familiar, it is defined like that. T minus tau 1 will be 0 till t is, when t is less than tau 1. That means it will become 1 for t greater than or equal to tau 1. Which means this last equation here will start working only when this will become 1. So it becomes 1 when t is greater than tau 1. So tau 1 is the total time required for the first production of the antibody of the virus and the B cells are interacting. So this involves two biological steps: conversion of B cells to plasma cells and production of antibodies from plasma cells. So that time delay will be naturally there, and the antibody production starts very in a very great way only after time tau 1. Now time delay tau 2 takes into consideration the time required to produce antibodies from the plasma cells, because as I said, it's a process that involves a finite time, so that has to be taken care of. So at any given time t, the antibody will be seeing the count of the B cell which was there before a time tau 2. That is why we call it a delay differential equation. So after introducing these two delays, details you can find in this paper, we will start to solve the system. In this case also, the asymptotic values can be found out easily, because there the time delay doesn't matter. We are now looking at t tending to infinity situation. So we get all these values. This is the reproduction number, and the value of this v, equilibrium value of the virus v, is given by this complicated equation. One solution will be v equal to 0. The other solution is given by this cubic equation. You must remember that we already have a five-dimensional system here. The expression for v is now a v raised to 4 type. So we can say that either v will be 0 or we will have three solutions. One of them is negative. The other solution that we get as v1 is given by this expression. So here I have used some simplifying assumptions to do it analytically. But the important thing to note is r0 will become greater than 1 only if this value of f is less than this. And that means to make it less than 1, we have to have a critical value for fc. And what is this fc? That fc occurs here. So this is a parameter which decides the rate at which the antibody can be produced. And that has a critical value above which we can actually say that the antibody will be able to kill the virus and the disease will become free. Now we look at the stability of the equilibrium state. This is a 5-dimensional 5x5 Jacobian. I am not going to details, but we can actually solve it, get the eigenvalues. But here stability also, just I will tell you one thing about the delay equation, because stability also we have to consider in the presence of delay. So what we do is, first we consider stability without the delay. This is a higher dimensional system, we use the root for this condition and get the stability parameter. So this in the parameter plane of F and K. K is the production of virus, F rate of production of virus, F is the rate of production of antibody. So these are the two crucial parameters that decides the dynamics. In that parameter plane, I will mark regions where we have stability. So that means the values are negative. That is the blue region. The eigenvalue is positive in the red region. So we can choose stable regions for these parameter values. This is for tau 2 equal to 0. And this is the corresponding dynamics for the variables, how what happens to these variables in course of time. Now, how do we find out the stability in the presence of tau 2 when it is non-zero. What we do is we see what happens to the eigenvalues as tau 2 becomes non-zero. So this is also some detail, but when one can actually do it and then identify the parameter plane where when tau 2 is not zero, we get stability. For that region, I am plotting this. So with time delay, we get oscillatory states like this. When the time delay is very small, we can see that the virus count will go to a steady value. But when the time delay is large, it will go through an oscillatory behavior like this. Now coming to secondary dengue infection. In the secondary dengue infection, as I said, we have a homologous antibody from the secondary infection and a heterologous antibody from the primary infection. And this antibody from the primary infection is in a way helping the virus reproduction. So that is why we call it antibody-dependent enhancement of virus or ADE. This is one very crucial thing regarding the secondary infection, and that is what makes the secondary a fatal infection. I'm skipping this biology slide, I'll go to these equations. So we have two antibodies now. This is from the primary infection. This is remaining from the primary infection. This is from the secondary infection. See, here, depending upon the antibody from the primary infection will be effective only if its concentration is within some range. Very small concentrations will not help it. So we are introducing a dynamic switch here to take care of that. And I am introducing a correlation factor W, which takes care of the similarity between the two types. So with that, so this is a switch which will be zero when if this is less than a minimum concentration. It is -1 when it is between these two. When it is -1, that means it is going to become plus here, and it will actually assist the virus production. And then it is 1 when it is greater than that, then it is not assisting the virus production but decreasing it. Now this correlation W, sorry for this typo here, correlation W is a measure of the relatedness between the different serotypes. So that will help us out when they are binding to the virus. Extent of binding depends on the complementarity between the antigen and the antibody. And also it depends on the concentration of the earlier antibodies. So with this, we can actually calculate for different values of the parameters how the total antibody count is more in secondary infection. That is this antibody-dependent enhancement. So we could actually show from our model how this happens. This is actually verifying our result with the data from a hospital in Pune. We could show how this enhanced production during secondary infection happens. The severity of the infection will depend upon how close they are. So it is a function of this correlation factor, as you can see, and it increases with that. And this is the stability region in the presence of these two different values of W. Now let me conclude in the next 5 minutes how we can go to adapt this to our COVID case, to take care of this COVID infection case. So modern COVID. So this is actually not my work. I have taken from a latest publication, which is shown here. And then what I find is we have uninfected cells, which is actually the differentiated respiratory epithelial cells. Those are the cells affected by the coronavirus. And then you have infected cells, because this is a very acute infection. We are not considering their growth, etc., as I have taken earlier. And then the virus count also we are considering. Now, the main thing in this case is we don't know when the start of infection is, because it takes some time. So we use some data fitting. The data fitting is used to find out what is the count. So we are taking the time backwards as per the model that is shown by continuous lines here. And the circles indicate the data. This is taken from a hospital in Wuhan. And then -14 days, -7 days, -3 days, like that. Assuming the infection started 3 days before, 7 days before, and 14 days before. So this is where data fitting can help us to estimate these values, etc. And in this case also, we know that it remains latent, so we should have a latent phase E also to take care of this infection. And then we do a data fitting, but the fitting is not good in this case. But that what they have done is they have introduced this model with immune response or T cells. And then the virus is given a target cell limited or a logistic type of growth as PV into 1 minus V by K with a carrying capacity K, that is the maximum for the viral load. And the T cells are growing based on a proliferation which follows a log sigmoidal form with a saturation constant of KT. and that m is an index there which is taken to be 2, and then you find that there is a very good fitting with the data. So again, they are doing for minus 17 days and minus 14 days, and then they are counting this virus count, and then it is fitted with data. So we can see that there is good enough fit there. So that is only to illustrate how the data fitting to some extent is going to help us improvise our model or optimize our model. So what I have so far said is actually a very simple model and how to incorporate various factors into this simple model. But you can see that further extensions are possible. So how do we do extensions? These simple models, as I said, are ordinary differential equations. This will reduce the mathematical and computational complexity. However, as I showed in one case, delayed differential equations are most often required because all these biological processes require a delay because of the multiple processes involved from one stage to the next. And most important, I feel, that if the time scale I have taken to be the same for all of them, which strictly speaking is not correct, because the production rate of the virus, it may have a totally different time scale. I have taken everything as d by dt, that t is the same. It need not be in general. So you have to think of introducing multiple time scales into the model. And then heterogeneity, because now we have thought of a uniform mixing of all these things. So we have not considered variations locally, whether there is a variation one organ to another organ, there is a variation. Such things are not considered. So if those are also considered, what will happen is it will become a partial differential equation, not an ordinary differential equation. Still, that is doable. And again, the most important factor is to introduce a stochasticity or randomness into the model. I always feel that for any biological system, this is very, very important, because taking this beta to be the same, or any parameter beta, lambda, d to be the same and constant value throughout for one person or between two different persons, it's not correct. So ideal thing will be to give a small spread for this. You take every parameter to be spread around a small central value, a little bit of spread. That means every iteration or integration will take a slightly different value. I think that will be more relevant for the actual biological situation. So these are, in my concept, some of the extensions that are possible to optimize your model. Anyway, for you, it is for you to decide whether how to optimize the level of biology that is incorporated in the model, such that the mathematical and computational complexity is manageable and still you can get new knowledge out of it. Even though predictions over a long time may not be possible, at least some predictions should be possible. So when you make a model, these are the key factors that you have to keep in mind. With this, let me conclude my talk and thank you very much for your attention. Hello.
Thank you, ma'am. For such a wonderful talk. And with the present pandemic situation going on, your talk is the apt for the current situation. And I hope all the participants here have thoroughly enjoyed it. So now I would like to take up a few questions. Since we don't have much time, I would like to take up two questions from the ones that we received. Okay. Should I go ahead?
Yeah, please.
Okay. So the first question is, drug and immunity both reduce the impact of virus. So why don't we consider the dynamics together?
So I think I have considered together in the last model of HIV that I considered, it is there. Immune system is also there and drug is also there. Both are there. We can consider both together, because immune system is that Z variable that I have incorporated, and then the drug effect of drug is going. I didn't consider a drug that can boost the immune system. If that is the question, that I have not considered, but that's also possible. You can have some therapy to boost your immune system, but that I have not considered. But that will also go into that parameter which is coming in the Z equation as production of immune cells. Because if you remember, I have considered this CTL cell production. No, that was considered along with drug. It's possible to consider both.
Okay, so the next question is, how accurate are the simple models in determining the disease dynamics, and can these be extended to complex human body?
So accuracy, again, as I said, depending upon your success in estimating the parameters accurately. So that is what decides the accuracy. Also the numbers. So biology students should know what should be the initial count of the cells, what should be an estimate. You can take it as 10 raised to 4, 10 raised to 5. That depends on the situation. So this also, The simple model may not give exact results because you may have overlooked some important factors. So if you are sure that you have not overlooked any factor and included all probable biological processes, then I think the model will be more or less accurate. But then you have to consider the spread of the parameters. So the parameters are to be estimated by data fitting. You should have some actual data, just like I have shown for this corona case, and then fit them and try to fit them such that you fit your model or such estimate the parameter to fit that data. Then use that data, use that parameter to predict what will happen later. So that is what is normally done. So if everything is done like that, it should give very good results. Even though some variations and heterogeneities are there, on the average, I think these models can give you very good values, even for human cases.
Okay. Hello. Thank you, ma'am. So this is like the end for talk one. We will now move on to our talk.
Just a minute. Ma'am, you can feel free to answer the questions in the Q&A box. You can just type in the answers there so that the students will get a direct answer.
Can I get it downloaded?